sent out a prayer today, and I said, Holy Spirit, I want to be informed about the next step right now, not tomorrow, not an hour from now, right this moment. I said, what do you have for me? So I pull up to a stoplight and the light turns red and I said, okay, what's going on? The car pulls up beside me. Someone starts yelling at me from the car. I say, Roll down my window. And it turns out to be an old acquaintance I hadn't seen for quite some time. And his parting words to me were, it's about to get very, very interesting. We're talking about the world situation at the stoplight, yelling. And he says, it's about to get very, very interesting. Count on it, man. He's certain about it. So, wow, that's the message, right? The Holy Spirit gave me the message just like that. It's about to get extremely interesting. No question about it. So, I hope I'm prepared. I hope you're prepared. Do they test for spiritual IQ when you're growing up in school? Does anyone test for that? Does anyone know what their spiritual IQ is? I'm just curious. What kind of test they have for that? Is there like a Wonderlic test for spiritual IQ, or I don't know. I don't know. Maybe somebody knows their spiritual IQ. Well, we better have a very high spiritual IQ right now. I continue to be pummeled by the world, by the doubling down, sleazy tactics of the ego. And you can't confront the ego. People will freak out if you do. They'll commit suicide if you confront them with what's wrong with the ego, because they think you're throwing them into an abyss. It's madness. And what is being done here? Nothing that I can see is being done about anything. So again, it is going to be very interesting what happens. I'm trying to do my part, but how that fits in and what's going to happen with the world is very difficult to say, because we have an unacknowledged severe continuity problem. It's the only problem we have. There's only one problem in the universe, and that's the continuity problem. There isn't any other problem whatsoever. As long as we pursue resolving other problems, we only make the matters worse. Only make matters worse. And until someone admits that they have a continuity problem, I don't see anything that can be done to help them. Nothing. So, you could say that the thing to do is to just retreat into seclusion until people have accepted the fact they have a severe continuity problem. Because until that point, there's nothing anyone can do. Sure, you see all the ladies going to yoga in the morning, and people go to meditation classes, and nothing's happening. Continuity problem is not being really touched on at all. People go to their, places of worship and all that, and nothing is happening. There's no real repentance. Repentance means to say, I have a severe continuity problem. And it's non-negotiable. See, this continuity problem is not negotiable. We don't negotiate with problems, say, okay, God, you say I have a continuity problem, I say I don't. Let's say that I'll trade you your continuity problem, and I'll accept a person problem. I have a person problem, or I have a health problem, or I have an ego problem or something. Now, facts are non-negotiable. Facts are non-negotiable. And we keep thinking that we're in some negotiation. We're not in any negotiation with anything. That's what I mean by repentance. Repentance is you drop the demand for negotiation. Continuity problem is our problem. It doesn't go away because someone says, I'll say you don't have it if I can say you have a person problem or a world problem. is still there. And we have this, you know, bizarre. But because we think that we can change reality, we feel reality doesn't apply to us. We feel that facts don't apply to us. So what do you do? How can you reach people? How can you reach a mind that says truth and facts don't apply to it? That it's going to change facts into whatever it wants. That truth is negotiable. That reality is negotiable. That you can negotiate with reality and get it to change. You know, how do you approach such a mind? You cannot. So it seems as though people have to bottom out, you know, before they will do anything about it, until they will finally realize, you know, maybe I've got to accept the facts. And the one fact we have to accept is we have a continuity problem, because we have been living with the belief that we're going to be able to change reality. So we've been acting as if this is going to happen for us, and preparing and imagining what it would be like, and we've forgotten what the facts are of reality. We've forgotten, but we don't have us experiencing for so long of facts. We keep denying them, saying, okay, that I got to negotiate this. Oh, this is something else I have to negotiate. And we work with materiality, where everything can be changed, right? We can rearrange atoms, molecules, structure, all. And so we think that truth is like matter. It's not. It's formless. It's an idea. There's nothing form-based that we can do anything at all to. Continuity problem is not form-based. Non-negotiable. People's attitudes, I just cannot deal with people's attitudes in the world, really. It just never ceases to stun me. How they simply never get around to even step one. Not even to step one. And they expect for you to wait as they negotiate with truth. They say, wait, I'm still negotiating with truth. There are no negotiations with truth. None. They say, as soon as I finish my negotiations, then you'll be able to teach much more easily, because I will feel much more confident and I won't have a continuity problem, is what they're saying. Now, my whole teaching is that how to get past the continuity problem. So it doesn't help me at all. People saying that they're negotiating and it'll make it easier. There's lunacy. They're just getting a worse continuity problem as they keep believing they can negotiate. I don't have any teaching other than the continuity problem. So if they say, well, make my teaching easier because they will not have a continuity problem, it makes my teaching completely unnecessary, if that was the case. So if my teaching is unnecessary, why should I hang around? See? So either my teaching is necessary or unnecessary. If negotiations are possible, then it's unnecessary. I shouldn't stick around. If negotiations are impossible, then I should stick around and teach the continuity problem. So it's either one or the other. Either people start working on the continuity issue, or I don't stick around because they don't think that they're going to have one, because they think that they'll be able to negotiate it away. The whole fact of a continuity problem is, it's the belief in being able to negotiate with reality, be able to change reality, that's caused the continuity problem in the first place. So simply engaging in that behavior longer is just making it worse. Doubling down. But as long as people keep doubling down, you know, there's no reason for me to wait, because they think that they won't need me. What they're really saying is, just wait, don't say anything yet, because we're not going to need you anyway. So just be quiet, because we don't want to hear what you say. And we'll just prove to you that you're not needed here. course, I know they do need help, but in that state of mind, they will not apply themselves. They will not accept an end to their attempted negotiations. They will feel that you're trying to throw them into an abyss, so that there's no teaching possibility there. Other than just some sort of vague presence they feel of happiness, and they say, wow, what's that, you know? And that's a possibility that, but as far as actually interaction, and, you know, no, there's no possibility. They feel that you're attacking them. So it's my own stupidity, really. Somehow I'm still a little stupid. My spiritual IQ is not sufficient. And this is probably everyone's problem, that we still think we see opportunity where there isn't. We still are waiting for the results of the negotiation, because they're promising us that they'll be a better student, you know, you'll be able to help them better as soon as they finish this negotiation. So you think, wow, okay, here's a good opportunity. Here's somebody who reassures me that they'll be very successful. Whatever it is I'm offering, they say, I'm sure I'll be able to be more successful once I get my self-esteem and, you know, everything great. Meaning, once they don't have a continuity fear, then they should have no problem dealing with the continuity fear. It's that kind of logic, illogic. They want to a priori say that they can dismiss the continuity fear by fiat, by becoming prime creator and saying, well, I my will is that there is no continuity problem, since everything that I create is what I want to create, even then there is no continuity problem. So the doubling down here in the world is people believing that once they be prime creator, they can simply say, I don't have a continuity problem, and it is so, you see, because they're not going back home. Just an amazing, it's such a crazy place, this world. I mean, you cannot hardly comprehend, you know, how insane it is. The continuity problem makes us all seem insane. It's like saying, as soon as I defeat God, I won't have a continuity problem. As soon as I change reality, I won't need to go back to it. You know, that's what they're saying. And I'm saying it's impossible to change reality, so you do have a severe continuity problem right now. And I say, well, I'm not finished trying to change reality. Once I get finished, and if I ever find out that I can't, then I'll pay attention. I say, well, you can't right now. Never I'll be able to, but you know, you cannot convince anyone of that. It's not possible. So I don't know what to do, but like my friend said, it's about to get extremely interesting, for sure. Not everybody is so stupid. Everyone knows that trap is coming. Some people think it's great because they think it'll prove that we're able to change reality. And others are saying, I'm not so sure about that. I think it's just going to be a lot of suffering and sacrifice. So once all the emotionalism dies down of various witch hunts, people start asking tough questions, saying, oh, wait a minute, you know. This doesn't add up. Things don't add up here. They don't add up at all here. Nothing adds up. Because the world remains in the darkest ignorance that it has a continuity problem. Why? Because it says as soon as it changes reality, it won't have a continuity problem, because it won't be going back to reality, because reality will have been changed. You see what I'm saying here? This is the central insanity of the whole situation. Let me go over it, reiterate it. They say, what continuity problem? As soon as I change reality the way I want it to be, I'll fit right in perfectly with it. Okay, so they say, you're nuts. What are you talking about, continuity problem? You're some kind of negative, pessimistic, defeatist, you know, negative force, dark force person saying that I can't succeed. What are you talking about, I can't succeed? You know, you're trying to undermine my success, is what they say. I'm saying, no. I'm just talking about facts. It's not the will of God that you can change the will of God, so you cannot do it. And so it doesn't get through to him. Apples and oranges, we're talking at cross purposes here. But clearly I say I am right, absolutely I am right. I've looked at the whole situation, I see the ego is wrong. The idea that we can change reality is wrong. It is mistaken, it is false. And to say that we cannot change reality is true, plain and simple. There's no wiggle room whatsoever here. And what they say is, you know, that once they change reality, and those who thought that reality couldn't be changed and have based their whole being on this will be completely irrelevant and have no place to fit into the new reality. And they're the ones that will have the continuity problem. You see how this is? This arrogance of the world. The world is so arrogant, it is just astonishing to me. Because it's like people going over a cliff or something. You feel so sorry for them, say, what? Stop. And they look at you like, no, you're the one who's going to be on the outs looking in. You who believe that reality can't be changed will then end up having this massive continuity problem trying to fit into the changed reality. And you'll have no standing whatsoever. Everyone will call you a complete idiot. You know, you'll be the lowest of the low. People will scorn you and say, what an idiot. So what the ego's done to me in my life is, says, look, I'll have mercy on you. You better start working on your problem because you're going to have a continuity problem fitting in with the changed reality. So I'm going to put you very, very low, the lowest, lowest person with no standing whatsoever in the world, so that you can, and then you have to gradually accustom yourself to this changed reality. You know, and so that's been my life because the madness of this world is so extreme that, you know, who can stand up to it? Very few have stood up to it. But at least I'm you know, seeing it. You know, that's a step in the right direction. And I say, why do I have such an incredibly lowly position in the world? And now it's even lower. It's like being, you know, squashed, saying, you don't get it, so fail. You know, in the change of reality, you can be destroyed. Your soul, your spirit can be destroyed. So they're saying, you are now set for, you know, spiritual destruction, because you weren't able to work on your quote-unquote continuity problem with the changed reality, or the presumed, assumed changed reality, soon to be here, so to speak. And that you've insisted that reality can't be changed, so your whole mindset is out of sync with the world. And so, first I had this very low places, low lower places. And basically I'm now like a sudra, picking up dead animals and you know, dead leaves, rotting sewage, you know, picking up all the most dead, decaying and dead and sick, yucky stuff. That's the position the ego has given me here, saying that that's good for you. And the ego says that's very good for you, it's very helpful for you. You're fortunate to even have that. The ego thinks that you really should be annihilated, but you're fortunate, it's giving you an opportunity to work on your continuity problem with the changed reality. So it's topsy-turvy here, upside down and completely backwards. And the world's doubling down on this whole thing because the continuity problem is unacknowledged. I really can't hardly believe why this is not. Maybe it's just people are unwilling to look at it. But you can just put all books aside, really. If you just admit that you have a continuity problem, from there, all clarity comes from that. Because you've gotten real. You're no longer doubling down. When you stop doubling down, then you start, clarification comes in. Because then you just compare truth and lies, and you say, wow, this is a lie, you know, this is true. Whereas if you're doubling down, you don't compare. You're saying, wait. I think I have a way to get rid of the continuity problem, just change reality. So essentially what everyone in the world is saying is, I think I have a way to get rid of the continuity problem. I just change reality, and therefore I don't have one. So it's changing reality, and then that does the job. So they never work on the continuity problem actually directly. They just say, we are going to get rid of it by changing reality. So maybe at some level they acknowledge, well, they say, well, there's a continuity problem, but it's not really a problem, see, because we're going to change reality. So there's no reason to acknowledge it. They say if we acknowledge it, it's merely actually making it worse because we're not working on changing reality, which is, they think, is the remedy for it. So they're not willing to even acknowledge it to the point of even looking at it and then trying to say, okay, well, ask, well, what do I do about this? Because they think they already know. Change reality. So why should they ask any questions? They already have the answer. And that's what I found in the world. People think that the only reason people are continuing on as they are in this world is they think they know the answer to the continuity problem being that of changing reality. So I look at everybody in the world and everybody seems very, you know, confident and like they have the answer to it. And I say, wow, am I the only one who doesn't feel so confident and has had to work so hard at this, you know? Doesn't seem to be anybody else even talking about the continuity problem. And it's because they feel we're getting very close to changing reality. As science gets into, you know, all the quantum string theory and antimatter and all this kind of stuff, the world is just assuming the scientists have got it. They'll get it. We'll get it. We'll just put enough pressure on reality and it's going to change. Like as if it was matter, you know. Reality is not matter and it's not antimatter. It's idea. I don't even say it's an energy, actually. It's an idea. So pressure has no... There's no such thing as pressure, actually. We're just pressuring symbols that we've made. That's all. So the just the astonishing arrogance of the world, it stuns. It's stunning. I'm always stunned by it. I get real mad at the Holy Spirit. I say, what are you doing? I mean, don't you realize that this is the world? This is the arrogance is here, and you're going to get hit by it every step of the way. There's not some point where, you know, the arrogance doesn't hit you. It hits you every day, constantly. And of course, I'm just complaining because I'm still getting hit by it. So I feel the Holy Spirit should have done more. But apparently, it's such a severe problem that it really takes a lot of patience. Because the fear of you know, you wanna you don't, it's like, you don't want to reconcile yourself to reality because everybody in the world will claim that that's going to cause you then to be on the lowest of the low in the new reality, and your continuity problem will be so severe you'll never be able to solve it, or it may take you an extremely long time to solve it. So there's this threat that going on that is really scary. And I think that's what holds us back, holds people back. You say, wow. I want to keep it just at the conceptual level, because if it goes to the level of feeling and I really accept true happiness, then but if the whole world will say that I'm going to end up being, you know, totally unhappy soon when the reality's changed, I'll be completely out of sync with it, won't know how to function in it, and I'll have just this incredible, massive continuity problem. I may just go into this hallucinating, dreamlike state for, you know, eons in order to try and cope with it, and I'll need a lot, you know, endless therapy. So there's this enormous threat that hangs over our heads this way. That has to be what it is. Has to be, because you know, nobody's that stupid. You know, I'm not that stupid to not be able to work on the situation. It has to be just this massive feeling of threat. That's why I still accept a lowly position in this world. It's ridiculous. I mean, it's the craziest thing ever for my position in the world. But the ego, I must be, you know, accepting it out of fear that I better, you know, I better work on at least somehow trying to or the price you pay in the new reality to have the ideas that I have is that you must be extremely lowly, otherwise you're going to be annihilated. So the price I pay for even being here is that I have to appear to be, you know, not a threat to anybody, so to speak, as far as status is concerned. Or else people get very frightened. Very angry, that kind of thing. So it's like an appeasement thing. That I'm like super lowly as an appeasement. Of course, they crucified Jesus as an appeasement, saying, look, the only way you can be here is if you're dead. They accepted, then they accepted Jesus' death. They said, okay, you know, we'll have some relics, or we'll have a memory of you, or, you know, that kind of thing. We'll accept you that way, but we can't accept you here because we don't have the appropriate therapy for you. Your continuity problem is so severe that it hurts us. You know, it traumatizes us because we were, you know, we don't want to see a brother so completely bereft of any sense or logic. It's horrible. But they say, but don't worry, we have a way to annihilate you, so you won't suffer anymore. We say, that's kind of like put you out of your misery. We can't bear your suffering. We can't bear to see anyone so insane, so we need to put you out of your misery. It's like that. The arrogance has always been too much for me in this world. And I always ask the Holy Spirit, try, you know, put me somewhere where I can eventually be able to handle this. It's too much. It's really too much. The arrogance of this world is really too much. Very few have been able to handle it. Very few. Because again, they do look at you with like you're the, you know, it's the saddest thing ever. Oh, look what's happened to you. You've decided to turn your back on life, turn your back on truth, turn your back on the new truth, the new life, the new this, the new that. Something went terribly wrong. You weren't able to adjust. What a pity. So mercy killing, you know. Mercy killing. The world is headed towards mercy killings from its standpoint. Now you got to realize the world is insanely arrogant, and both insane and insanely arrogant. And they truly look upon those who know truth, express truth, and are repentant and realize I have a severe continuity problem and are working on it. They look at those as they need to engage in mercy killing. Maybe they think maybe if we stop it now, it might they might be able to bounce back from it or something, right? So they think that that by actually working to resolve the continuity problem, the real root continuity problem, is you're, you know, slipping down to an eternal hell, that you'll be burned in a lake of fire forever. And so they think of mercy killings, at least maybe they kill the body to save the soul, because, you know, this is their mentality of the world. The mentality of the world is to engage in, from their standpoint, mercy killings. From our standpoint, it's complete berserk insanity. or simply engaging in lynching and murder. And again, it says that someone in a frenetic, insane state of mind. That's how we would view it. But they can be so persuasive that they need to save your soul through your sacrifice, that literally you can crumble. I think at some point in my life, I must have crumbled under the pressure. For sure I did, yeah. So it really takes such great healed perception and clarity to not crumble. And so what do we do? What do we do at this point in the world where we realize those who are aligned, intuitively aligned with truth, knowing that, hey, we can't change reality. We cannot cause such a thing as time-space. We cannot link moments. We cannot change our freedom. We can't change what we truly are. All of that, we cannot do that. And we're realizing, you know, we just have been engaged in a whim, a whimsical dream. What do we do? What do we do at this point? Now, in the past, it's been organized religion that is engaged in witch hunts, persecuting people for various reasons. Now it's the secular bureaucracy that's engaged in witch hunts. And so it's still the same old witch hunts. Nothing's really changed. And now they say, well, we've got to re-educate you. You know, we'll strip you of your livelihood. Take away all your credit. Take away your ability to survive in any way, but they'll put you in some sort of training, re-education training program, like the camps in Siberia or something. They're re-educating you as to how to function properly in the new paradigm, the new change reality, so that you can, you won't be such, you won't be a misfit kind of thing. So that's their plan. That's their plan here, at least initially. Actually, what they want to do is engage in mercy killings. But there's enough will still left in the world where they can't get to that right now. Okay, that's the good news. At least not directly. But they do have a few tricks up their sleeve. Actually, yeah. I was shown the future, and I'm just looking at it. It's like, wow. What they're going to do is they're going to put you at the brink of these re-education, and you will feel so terrible about it, so horrible about it, that then they will come, the good cop, bad cop, then the good cop will come along and say, look, you know, you don't deserve this. You don't deserve this. Come with me, and I'll give you a gentle death. You know, the mercy killing is still there, but it's a good cop, bad cop type of setup that they've done. You'll feel so low about being stripped of all dignity and made to look like a complete pariah, and being told that you are actually have the lowest spiritual IQ on the planet, and you have to raise your spiritual IQ, in other words, accept that reality can be changed, because they look and say, look, this is reality, and look, we're changing everything. And you say, no, these are all just symbols, dream symbols. You're not changing reality at all. And they say, well, that's a sign of insanity. You need to, you know, become a materialist. So you'll be so devastated spiritually by the thought of having become a materialist, getting them to having go brainwashing, and they'll say, no, we're not going to kill you, we're going to help you. Then the good cop will come along, who seems to say, oh, those bad boys, you know, they're trying, that's awful what they're trying to do to you. come with me, come with me. The feminine side will come in, the protectress, you know, so come with me, come with me, come with me. I'll make sure that they don't do that to you, right? And you say, oh, great, thank you. Of course, she's leading you to the mercy killing, you see. And when you realize that, it'll break your spirit so bad that you'll say, okay, what the heck? I mean, this place is just so terrible that even this tricks me. Forget it. So I was warned about this a long time ago. It's going to happen. I was shown during the presidency of the 44th presidency. This was back in, when was this? 2001 or 1999, or it was a long time ago. I think it was like 15 years ago. I was shown, now this was before Bush was elected. It was back 1998 maybe. I had no idea who George Bush was. I don't follow politics. And I was shown his election, his initials and election, and then I was shown what happens, and the 44th president comes into the picture. And then a little later, I had a dream that showed the 44th president. During that reign of the 44th president is when this re-education program will commence. And again, they have this setup, this trick, from what I'm seeing, to try and get to mercy killing, where you'll accept mercy killing. Of course, you don't have to. You can say no to it. But the thing is you will be so disheartened by the situation, thinking that here's our savior, someone's here that really understands us. And it turns out the feminine is in on the whole plot. I'm telling you, the feminine of this planet is absolutely in on this whole plot. In fact, they're the ones who have, by and large, hatched the whole plot. See, they want to get to the mercy killings, actually. But they know that there's the masculine will wants to fight, doesn't want that. So they set up this re-education thing, which seems to give us a fighting chance type of thing. And then when the SEALs feels like, oh my gosh, I wish I had an option, then the feminine will come in and say, yeah, I have a better, much better option for you. And then it turns out to be a mercy killing, and we'll just like say, wow, I can't trust anything, can't trust anybody, I just want to die to this whole situation. And they think that the death of the body enables you to die to the whole situation. It doesn't. The body is nothing, it's just a symbol. The mind will still be confused about the whole situation. So I have to bring these things up, at least look at this, because it looks like this is what's happening. Now, I refuse to go along with the feminine, the mercy killing thing. I believe I've seen through it, you know, so I refuse to gloss it over, which the ego was wanted me to do a project that would portray the feminine in the very best light possible, okay? Make it seem like that women are irreproachable, they could never do such a thing. But it's not true. It's not true at all. It's just that they can superficially appear to be kind and helpful to you. But remember, insanity thinks that mercy killing is being kind and helpful to you, is being compassionate, because they think that might save your soul. So you have this feminine thing that we're very compassionate. And so you say, you feel like, oh, there's compassion for me. They say, yeah, we don't want to see you having to be re-educated. Why? Because they think that gives you more time for your soul to be damned, you know, that you might fight against it. And they think, look, the best solution is mercy killing, so your soul will not be destroyed. Maybe you can have another life and work at it or something, or at least that give you some hope. So they think they're being compassionate, actually. They think they're being very compassionate and helpful for you. And you pick up a feeling like, we're here to help you. We're very compassionate. And then you're coming off the rebound from the terror of being re-educated, so you don't even really vet the situation at all. It's like when you're on the rebound from a relationship that's ended, and you just feel like, my God, that was so terrible, so horrible. I just can't believe it. And then someone says, comes along, and I can feel your pain. It's terrible. I'm so compassionate. I want to help you. And you just, you know, any port in a storm. so you don't vet the situation at all. Into the fire, actually. Good cop, bad cop. Now, every time I see a media woman, I cringe, and I have a revulsion, and there's something inside of me that says, you know, just get away, get away, get away. So, you know, there's something deep within us that says these people are lying to us. They're setting us up. There's something about the media, the women in the media, as they're talking, I feel they're deceptive, very deceptive, that they're putting on a superficial act, and deeper within, they have a very severe agenda in mind, very severe agenda, for me, for sure. That definitely, I feel is super strong, super strong. I don't feel that way towards all women, no. The feminine, they're, but it's the media, the ones in the media. I just thought, whoa. And my heart starts, you know, being like, there's something, you know, the danger. That's how I react to the whole situation. And the ones that after every single sporting contest, it's always the woman grabs the hero and says, and starts interviewing him, you know, like they're in control of the outcome, like somehow they're responsible for the outcome, and then we're supposed to get used to something. It's the weirdest thing, you know. It's like I always say, whoa, something here is not right. It's like the man, the hero, the one who, you know, has won. Now he has to have himself be interviewed and answer the questions that the female reporter is demanding that he answer. And you can tell they're always very nervous about it. It's like why you know, there's something that isn't right about the whole setup of this world right now. There's something, if you have a detector of danger, if you have something that detects, like you feel like a snare is being set, that's the feeling. I say there is a snare being set here in this world. And I'm just trying to out that snare. You know, we talk about outing people. Well, we should out the media. We should out this snare. We should out this trap. You see, what it's saying is that the winners go with the woman. The winners get the woman. The woman's interviewed him, and then they're palling. And like, you see, this is your reward. You get to talk with me. Something about, is there some, there's some deep setup here about emotional setup that's going on. I've been noticing how it all develops. The whole media, the way the media is developing, is a very, very nasty thing. It's a trap for the world. I'm extremely distrustful of the media. Have been my whole life, but now it's kind of like the women are saying, don't worry, you can trust us. All the while, they're totally in on the whole thing, and they're the ones that are pushing it, and they're the ones that are putting up a facade for it, so you don't recognize what's going on. All the while, they're saying, don't worry, you can trust us. We're kind and compassionate. That kind of thing. And you know, you say, whoa, this is scary. Because men are super susceptible to that, and the world is in general. I think women are too, although I think women can see through other women a lot better than men can, actually. But for some reason, they're not speaking up. Because they're afraid that if the plot is uncovered, and they see how much women have been actually hatching this plot, it will rebound onto them, so that people have a negative, will have an overall negative opinion of women, so they don't say anything. They say, well, I don't want to, you know, cause that problem for myself. But I've seen that women can see through other women easily. They say, wow, that's a phony. You know, that person's just, you know, I'm amazed how clearly they can see just like that. They know, wow, that's a liar. That's a deceiver. And men, they can't say that. You know, they're being conditioned to, yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am. You know, like a slave. You've just won this huge, you know, sporting contest, and then you're hauled over there, and there's this glamorous woman say, okay, now, I'm here with them, though. Now, wow, nice win, huh? How did you do this? And you're forced into association with that. It's telling, is giving all men a message that they have to succumb, they have to accept what the women, you know, we have to somehow accept this situation. And I know for a fact a lot of men are very uncomfortable with it. Very uncomfortable for very good reason. Very good reason. Now, it may have something to do with we're so used to women interviewing now, the heroes and the successful men, that we feel anyone that women are interviewing in a positive light must be successful and a hero. So they may then start transferring over to interviewing, what, hybrids, alien hybrids, interviewing those who want to carry out these pogroms or the re-education thing and say, hi, we have today, we have this so-and-so, and he is, and we're so used to saying, oh, okay, she's interviewing the top dog, you know, the ones who are successful, and we think, okay, I need to feel good about this and pay attention to it and accept what the person says. There's something kind of like that that's going on. There's something very devious going on here in the world. Very devious. And it's the good cop, bad cop thing is being set up. We're being set up to accept alien domination of this planet. We're being set up to accept all sorts of genetic manipulation on this planet. We're being set up to we're being set up to accept doubling down on trying to change reality is what we're being set up for. And the females are playing, you know, actually the leading role in all of this. Now, of course, the men are doing all this experimentation and, they're doing their thing too, right? Which is very bad also. But the ones that are running interference and that are marketing it, that are glossing it over, making it seem acceptable, are the females of the planet. They're totally in on it. Totally in on it. So both the males and the females are totally in on it. But we tend to blame the males, and that's the good cop, bad cop thing. We're being set up to think that by blaming the men and then escaping what they want for us, that we're going to safety. We're not. I think we're going into mercy killings. It's kind of like the Nazis saying, don't worry, we'll get you out of these ghettos. We're going to relocate you to a better place. And then get in the cattle cars and then go to this place. And they say, okay, this is just a way station until we get some more land for you, you know. Once we win the war, we're getting more land and, you know, we'll get you out of the ghettos or whatever. You know, they promise them various things. Calm down, cat. So, always the doubling down on trying to change reality is devious, very devious. It's so devious that those who are trying to repent can have a very difficult time seeing it, very difficult time. Which is why I've worked with the Holy Spirit so much, asking, please help. And the Holy Spirit's pointed out so much to me. He said, look at this, look at this, look at this, look at this, look at this. And I keep looking. I say, wow, yeah, there's something wrong here. And I have a very difficult time even imagining such a thing, you know. Because I don't have a belief system that supports it. And most people in the world look at women as good. They're good. The mother is good. The mother is the one that feeds you, takes care of you, protects life. But you see, we have a situation here where they think they're protecting your soul. You see? And that's the problem. They say, well, we got to kill the body to save the soul here. Because the body is obviously dominating the soul, they think, because the body is talking about the truth that reality can't be changed and that everyone has a continuity problem. And so they say, well, that must be coming from the body and not the spirit. Because they say, we know the spirit knows that reality can be changed. So that they insist that the evil is coming from the body, this delusion. And they say, look, your body may contaminate your spirit because we know that reality can be changed. So they think the body can contaminate spirit. So they say, we need to kill your body to keep the spirit from becoming too contaminated. See what I'm saying? Now, I didn't set out to do this video like this at all. I had a bunch of continuity practices I want to do, but this is just what's coming out. And it's ringing true to me. It's ringing very true. That now I see they think the body can contaminate the spirit, kill the body to save the spirit. That's why they killed Jesus. They said, Jesus, your body's contaminating your spirit so badly. We're going to do you a favor and kill you and save your spirit. At least minimize the contamination. And then maybe you have a chance to rehabilitate. So in no way do I trust the feminine in this world. In no way. They're absolutely head over heels involved in the entire situation of deception and mercy killing. Absolutely. Again, they think they are the heights of compassion, that they're superior compassion to the males. The males want to re-educate the body, but they say, no, because that's given the body a chance to contaminate the spirit even more. So they say mercy killing will save the spirit, you know, and then be able to have a better body sometime. So, you know, they think that they're heroines, that they have the will to help better than the men do. That's what I'm getting. The whole thing of feminism, radical feminism, all the stuff that's happened, the women getting the media, dominating the media in so many ways, controlling the whole social narrative. Realizing that from the very, all they think that they are more compassionate, that they know better how to treat this quote-unquote continuity problem from their angle, that those who say reality can't be changed, they're the ones who have a continuity problem in relation to the changed reality. See what I'm saying here? It fits. It definitely fits. So it is getting real interesting now, isn't it? Because I've been able to out this whole dynamic now. I don't know anyone else who's been able to do this, unfortunately. I wish someone else would have, so I don't have to stick my neck out. If there was others really outing this, I'd say, great, I'm all with you. But no, people are still deluded about this. They just can't believe it. Well, this is where it's coming from. See, they just can't believe that women could be actually involved in this. Although in Nazi Germany, women were heavily involved in the Nazi program. Some might even say they drove it. They insisted upon it, actually. They had men do the dirty work, of course, as always. But, you know, they pushed the agenda from behind the scenes. Well, same thing. In this instance, you may have the women lure men into mercy killings, and then they'll have the men do the dirty work. But it's really their agenda, actually. Thinking that they're saving your soul, saving your spirit by killing the body, and thus they're not killing you, they're saving you. They're saving you. Now, it's true the body has no value, but neither does killing the body have any value. If the body has absolutely no value at all, how can killing the body have any value? It doesn't. In fact, the body is very valuable for the purpose of communication and helping people with the continuity problem here. So it does have that value. But killing the body has absolutely no value whatsoever, none. Keep in mind that Jesus resurrected the body. He said, look, body doesn't have any value. So from that standpoint, I'm showing you that. But it does have a value through communication. So I'm showing you that I raised the body up. And God does want the body, use the body for communicating truth here. See? So that's what he showed. I mean, he met many times with the apostles in the resurrected body. Had Thomas put his hand in the side in his hands to feel the marks, the nail marks, etc., and the spear mark. And so he could say, yeah, this is the resurrected body. I did resurrect the body. And then talked, gave teachings with the apostles, would help. In other words, communicated helpful information to them. Very important. So, killing the body has no value at all. Those people who think that the body is somehow contaminating the spirit are insane. And they have a severe continuity problem. Now, I know how to treat the continuity problem. So, and which is very important. And you need to know that someone knows how to treat the continuity problems. It's very important, because then you can withstand this whole thing. Because they'll say, well, you're telling us we have a severe continuity problem, but you don't have any remedy for us. So, you know, if you really believe that, you would have some answers for us, but you don't, so you must be insane. You see what I'm saying? That they'll push that on you. So it's very important for everyone to know that there is a way to treat this continuity problem. I'm able to treat the continuity problem. I know how to do it, and I've treated my own continuity problem to the point where I've actually had the vision of oneness several times. And it's right there, very close. And so I know how to treat it. I know it can be done. Absolutely, it can be done. It can be done in less than a lifetime, actually. And even quicker than that, because I have, you know, I've developed the tools now to much more directly work on the continuity problem and save even more time. So nobody needs to succumb to this diabolical plot, the male-female diabolical plot, frying pan and fire plot, mercy-killing plot, thinking that the body is contaminating the spirit. Not true. Not true. The body is neutral. The body is nothing. Its only value lies in communicating the truth to help people work on the continuity, to help spirit that is in has this continuity problem to help the spirit with this. Help spirit with this. So I'll try to do some continuity exercises. I've been working on this, of course. I'm always working, trying to help. And I have all these, of course, I have all these many. Drag these out here. All these many cards here. Must be 30 of them or so. And I recently have done a whole set on the continuity problem. Yeah. And that's how you start. That's how you start. Is you simply start out by saying, I don't have a time problem. I have a continuity problem. The time problem has absolutely no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. See, the ego wants you to spend all your time chasing after innumerable problems. I have hundreds of problems written down here that we think we have. Not one of them is valid. Not one of them is valid. Because if it weren't for the continuity problem, we would stop trying to change reality this instant, and we wouldn't have any problem at all. Because the very next moment, we would be creating, thinking the thoughts we think with God, creating as the will of God is, and all of this fear and form wouldn't be there, and we wouldn't have any problems whatsoever. So really, the only problem we have is the continuity problem. And I have a cat problem right here, actually. I don't have a cat problem, I have a continuity problem. Maybe the cat's saying, ah, you got one problem. So we can practice the continuity problem. I've been practicing it for months, and it bears fruit. It really bears fruit. I can actually put this cat inside, can't I? Let me do that. All right, just one moment. Okay, now I don't have a cat problem anymore. Okay, so any rate, I'm certainly going to practice, make these available online. So at least you realize it is possible to work on the continuity problem, and maybe you can actually start doing it. And I highly advise this. It will enable you to stand up to the pressure that's going to be brought to bear on people in this world. It may not be you right away. It may be somebody else, and you'll start feeling the fear from that. Say, uh-oh, if they got them, they might get me. And you start getting very fearful, and maybe become so stressful, and people be committing suicide. They're so scared. If you know that you can practice the continuity problem, you will not succumb to this situation that's coming up. You will not succumb. So just the ability to practice the continuity problem is all important. See, I don't have a delicate problem. I have a continuity problem. The delicate problem, any delicate problem, has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. I don't have a touchy problem. I have a continuity problem. The touchy problem has no value whatsoever to me. Only the vision of oneness has value. I don't have a dangerous problem. I only have a continuity problem. Any dangerous problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. So I put these in different categories, actually, and that we can work on them in the categories that enables you to focus in on certain areas of thinking that you have a problem there. Remember, the only problem we have is the continuity problem. This is a fact. It's like somebody, for instance, let's say you were grabbing your throat, choking yourself, and you're turning, your arms are turning blue, the circulation, your face is all puffed up and red, you're not breathing, you're losing all your strength, and you have all these symptoms, you know, so many problems in the body, right? Now, what's the problem? Does the doctor come and say, your hands feel very cold. I want to, you know, let me rub your fingers. Let me see what's wrong with the circulation here in your fingers. Or say, your face is turning blue. I'm going to study this interesting phenomenon of blue face. You got a blue face problem. Or, like that. Or do you say, you've got a hand on your throat problem. Get the hand off your throat. The doctor says, just get the hand off your throat and everything will be okay, right? That's what we're talking about here. You can have all these symptoms from something, but if you don't treat the cause, the symptoms will remain. So the reason why we have all these symptoms, problems, just myriads and myriads and myriads of problems, really, just going over this list, you'd just be amazed of how problematical our lives are, actually. The only reason we have any of those problems is the continuity problem. That's it. Otherwise, the very next moment, we would choose to not have anything to do with perception, with form, with time, space. Nothing to do with it whatsoever. Finish the very next instant. Gone, like a dream, awakening from a dream, all the problems of the dream. Guaranteed that would happen. Guaranteed. So the only reason we're choosing the next instant to continue this dream is the continuity problem. There's no other reason whatsoever for it. So knowing this theoretically is good, but being able to practice for yourself is more important. So when you're in like a bad situation, like you're in being interrogated, maybe I'll do some more lists too. I don't have an interrogation problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a distrust problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a re-education problem. I have a continuity problem. The re-education problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value. Therefore, you're not going to engage. You're not going to dance with that. You're not going to dance with it. It takes two to tango. It does take two to tango. Now, also remember, you can also remember that since we're all one, when you say, I refuse to let anybody hurt me because I refuse to let them hurt themselves. Remember, if somebody hurts you, they're really hurting themselves. If someone attacks you, they're attacking themselves. So you say, I refuse to allow anyone to attack themselves. Which means they cannot attack you either. All attack is an attack on ourselves, our oneself. Attempt to attack our oneself, attempt to change it. So we do have power, but we first have to anchor in that we only have one problem. Otherwise, what happens is they'll get you looking at some other problem and you won't recognize that you have a continuity problem. And then they'll easily flip you into believing their agenda of changing reality is good, because subconsciously you'll think, well, that will take care of my continuity problem, my inner fear. See? Subconsciously, you'll feel that way, and then you'll be willing to wait for that as you work on this other problem. Wait for them to succeed. You won't try to escape from it. You say, no, okay, I need to, how do I not escape from it? Oh, I'll work on this other problem. Yeah, I have a darkness problem. I have a violence problem. I have a naivete problem. I have a helplessness problem. I have this kind of problem. I have that kind of problem. I have a regional problem. I have a freedom problem. You'll be working on that. All that is a delaying tactic. It's just a delaying tactic. But if you can deny, saying, I don't have any problem except the continuity problem, and I'm going to work on that problem, then you're not dancing with them. You're not waiting for them, you see. You're not waiting for them. You're not buying their shtick about being able to change reality, which makes the continuity problem null and void, right? Will nullify it. So it's a protection. It's a matter of protecting yourself at this time, very much so. We don't know how fast things can go. Things can go very fast, as we have seen. There are triggering factors. As I told you, the quote-unquote goddess of destructivity, the one who is really running this, which I feel is a female presence, actually, because she's able to get away with more by appearing to be compassionate. You see, the world is duped by this false female compassion, thinking that the body is somehow causative, because females feel they've created bodies and they feel that their creation must be causative. It's not. The bodies are not causative. They're nothing. They're just neutral, totally neutral. They're inert, neutral. Form is not causative. So this goddess of destructivity, I say it's booby-trapped the world in terms of incidents that will happen. Someone will say something, do something that causes a firestorm of upset, which causes new laws to be put in place, which causes a sweeping social agenda to steamroll opposition. All these things have been set up intentionally. They've had quite a few try to get rid of guns, for instance, situations that were to cut down our freedoms. 9/11 was one of them, to cut down on our freedoms, to cut down on our sense of independence, free thinking, allegiance to spiritual teachings and truth and spiritual practices. They want you to go along with their agenda. What they want to do is say, well, you can't disagree with this. Surely you must you believe, agree with this. I say, no, I don't agree with anything. I only agree that I have a continuity problem, and that's the only problem there is. See, I don't agree that there's any other problem. So this is the stand you need to take. Give me liberty or give me death means take this stand. Say, I don't have any problem except the continuity problem. There is no other problem. This sets them back on their heels. They can't deal with it. The ego can't deal with this. Because you're saying there's no deal. There's no negotiation. You can't negotiate with reality. By saying I have a continuity problem, it's the only problem I have, you're saying there is no negotiation with reality. Reality is non-negotiable, and you have repented and accepted this as the primary premise of your life, and that's it. And then the ego, you can't dance with that. You can't dance with that. So it's the form of the practice is super easy. I don't have a ... problem. I don't have a stupidity problem. I have a continuity problem. So you say, I don't have a, and then whatever problem, I have a continuity problem. And then the ... the stupidity problem, for example, has no value, has no value to me. The stupidity problem has zero value to me, none. Not an iota of value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me because it solves my one and only problem, which is the continuity problem. It's just like that. It's fourth part. I don't have a stupidity problem. I have a continuity problem. Okay, 1A and 1B. The continuity, the stupidity problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. 2A and 2B. It's like that. And then you can say, only the vision of oneness solves the continuity problem. And that's the third part. It's just one part of that. Only the vision of oneness solves the continuity problem. Or we can say, I only have one problem, and only the vision of oneness solves my one problem. So, I don't have a dot, dot, dot. I don't have a weakness problem. I have a continuity problem. The weakness problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. I only have one problem, and only the vision of oneness solves my one problem. This is how to protect from what is to come. It's how to protect from this arrogant insanity that is here in this world, and this double teaming, duplicious, good cop, bad cop trick that's going on. Very clever stuff. So you're hearing it here. You're hearing the real news here. This is the real news about what's going on in the world. And again, the Holy Spirit knows everything that's going on. Knows that it's, you know, the world is very insane and very unrepentant and very arrogant, thinks that it can change reality and therefore has this upside down backwards belief in the causality of the body, and the body can contaminate spirit, and that mercy killings are actually the best way to deal with this. And the Holy Spirit knows this. And I'm doing what I can to get this out. I'd like to be more effective in this. But of course, you have to be able to confess that you see through the deception of the world. Otherwise, people say, well, what are you doing this for? What are you talking about? We're going to be saved. Women are going to save us. Females will save us. I say, no, they won't. No, they most definitely will not. These are not the women of the past. You know, these are cooperatives, co-conspirators in the world. Many, not all for sure, of course. But very many, 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 many who have been conditioned and who have a role to play. They're playing a role. You can tell they're playing a role. At least I certainly can. I can see this. They're playing a role. They're not coming from their heart. It's a role they're playing, most certainly. You can tell when someone's coming from the heart. Because there's some willingness, you know, there to listen to spirit. Just be quiet and repentant. There's a repentant mood coming from the heart too. That's not what's happening in the world, male or female, in this world. But we've been taught to give the benefit of doubt to females. This is a big mistake. I never did that. Well, actually, I was pressured into, which is why I fell in, you know, into the problems I've had, as I was pressured into it. I refused to, and I got very severely persecuted for that, very severely. From men who were doing the bidding of women, actually. Women said, hey, you need to get this guy to give us the benefit of the doubt, and he's not doing it, so you need to, you know, rough him up, play the thug, and scare him, and that's what the men did. They, you know, didn't really want to do it, but they themselves were so scared of the women that they didn't dare not do it, actually. And I wasn't fooled about that, but nobody wants to listen to that because they think that the storyline's been told in this world that women are going to save the world. That is absolutely crazy. What women are trying to do is they're trying to save the idea of being able to change reality by getting rid of those who they think are contaminating this, you know, idea and mercifully preventing them, their spirits, from being annihilated, so to speak. You know, that's what is really going on. But, you know, who could ever, you know, accept such a notion, especially from like a young person saying those kind of things, as I was way back in the day, knowing what was coming. I said, hey, look, I'm telling you, stop worshiping women, thinking that they're all great and good. They're not. And you're going to find out later on just how bad, how cuckoo they really are. They're very much into form and time and the body and believing in creating a new reality. Very heavily invested in it. And they will defend that through what mercy killings, actually. And getting the men to do the dirty work and then blaming it on them, of course, later on. Oh, well, no, it was the men that did it, of course. Right. So who's going to accept that kind of talk? Nobody's going to accept that kind of talk. I'm at a place now, I'm able to do it from a lifetime of work and coming across this continuity exercise, which is empowering the ability to speak up. And other people, men and women, are not speaking up simply because they're too scared that they may, you know, end up on the bottom and have a gigantic continuity problem with the new, quote-unquote, new reality, the changed reality, which, as we know, will never happen. Will never happen. So you will not be on the bottom. You will not be on the bottom if you do the continuity practice. And the continuity practice has led directly to success for me, moments of successful breakthrough and tremendous velocity of breakthrough and ability to speak up, ability to stand up to the world. All of this has come from the continuity exercise. There's no question about it, because I was able to put my passion into it. I was able to be very adamant about it. When you do it, you can be very adamant about it. Say, I do not have a troublesome problem. I do not have a troublesome problem. I only have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem I have. The troublesome problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. I don't have an apathy problem. I do not have any apathy problem whatsoever. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem I have. The apathy problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. And be really, you know, strong. Be as emotional and passionate and strong and intense as you can. And this creates a tremendous vibe of protection for you. Tremendous. Because these fervent maniacs who think the body can corrupt the spirit, who want to kill you out of mercy, you know, they're very fervent about it, right? And they're going to try and bulldoze you emotionally. And you can say, no, I'm adamant in how I feel. I'm adamant. So you should do these exercises in an adamant way, as adamant as possible. It takes some practice before you can become adamant, because your mind's saying, should I really do this? And maybe it's going to cause me even worse problems. All right. Very great. Some necessary tough love here. Tough love. And I'm just doing the best I can, just being honest as I can, bringing up the problem so we can at least look at it. You know, it's just like, wow. But we can look at it and say, okay, is there something we can do? Absolutely, there's something we can do. We're not helpless. There's no abyss. We're not helpless in some helpless abyss. We have continuity exercise that we can do. And then the other exercises here, we can also do those. Once we do the continuity exercise, get strong with that, then we can start saying, hey, I feel total gratitude for this immense, massive, spectacular mountain of gold, this overflowing mountain of gold that is my I am happiness. I am, full stop, I am. And then you can do the positive exercises, okay? And really, 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 you know, get yourself immune to the madness of this world, which is, when I look at it, I just shudder with the madness that I see in the world, just shudder. It's almost paralyzing, but no, it's not quite, because we have this wiggle room now. Okay, I will do some exercises with this continuity exercises, so you can, Lisa, follow along and pick it up, and just start doing just once. Just say, hey, whatever it is, you know, you're walking down you're driving. I don't have a driving problem. I have a continuity problem. Or I don't have a music problem. I have a continuity problem. Oh, you're angry at politics. I don't have a politics problem. I have a continuity problem. Whatever irritates you and you worry about, hey, this is a problem for me. I don't, you know, on the internet, I don't have a troll problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a connectivity problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a job problem. I have a continuity problem. So you can find problems just right and left as you go through the day. And just start identifying them. Say, I don't have that problem. Practice, 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 practice. Otherwise, you won't acknowledge a continuity problem. You'll think all the other problems are valid, and then you'll think that you need to change the world in order to change these problems. And you'll go along with the notion of removing the lack of ability to tackle these other problems, which comes from your fear, your inner fear of a continuity problem, makes you feel weak, doesn't it? So you think your weakness comes from these other problems, and you will then believe that to solve the change the reality will enable you to then solve these other problems. It's that kind of reversal of thinking. Just say, I don't have any, you know, manipulation. I don't have a brainwashing problem. I don't have a re-education problem. I have a continuity problem. The re-education problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. I don't have a mercy-killing problem. I have a continuity problem. The mercy-killing problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. See? Nothing's stopping you from doing it. Nothing is stopping you from doing it. Except the threat that if you do it, and reality is changed, you may find, you'll theoretically find yourself with like an extremely terrible problem, except that will never happen. Will not happen. And we have the assurance of the great teachers that have worked with me, that I've worked with, that's not going to happen. It will not happen. There will never be such a situation. So we can go forward with, we can push the threat aside. And it takes will. You know the threat's a lie. So you just have to push it aside. It says, no, I'm not going to let you stop me from practicing. I'm not going to let you do it. It's finished. You're finished. Threat, you're finished. I'm on to you. I'm on to you. All I got to do now is practice, and you will recede and evaporate from me forever. And I won't invite you back either. Okay. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.